exposing the hate and exploring the love. This is the Truth Frequency Radio Network.
The views and opinions expressed on this broadcast do not necessarily reflect those of the network, producers, advertisers, or hosts, and belong solely to those who make them. Truth Frequency is a non-biased and non-partisan platform committed to presenting all aspects of the truth and allowing you, the listener, to decide for yourself.
And guess what, guys? Here we are. Well, good evening. This is not Chris. This is not Cherie. This is Tony Kudos, Cavern Forum. As most of you are aware of, they went off this weekend and they literally tied the knot. And so they're off taking a break, a well-earned break. They're chilling out in sunny California right now. Ha ha. And so we thought that we'd bring you a show this evening that's a little bit different. So this is the Beyond 2012 / Truth Frequency Radio Show, and we're very happy to be with you tonight. Now, I'll explain in a little while what's going to make this show very different, and you're going to enjoy this a lot. You're going to have two people here who I know you guys love to hear. I know you guys are going to love to talk to. I was thinking about setting it up as a phone line, as a phone in, but we're really thinking we might be a little bit shaky on that side for technical reasons. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to invite anybody who's got a question to come into truthfrequencyradio.com, come into the chat room. If you have a question, you know how to do it. You put question with a dash and then ask your question. We will do everything that we can to make sure that we address your questions. But you're going to have an opportunity tonight to meet two shamans, one from the Eastern discipline and one from the Native American discipline, and myself. And I'm not really quite sure how I'm going to quantify myself, but it's going to be interesting. We're going to give you the chance to ask the kind of questions that people really want to ask, like, how do I get into spirituality? How do I know I found the right kind of person? What does spirituality actually mean? What does it mean to be a shaman? And all of these questions we'll do our best to address. So right after the break, I'm going to bring Bill and Bill in. All right, it's William and Bill, but that's just my little English joke. But I'm going to bring them both in, introduce them to you. And you're going to have the opportunity to be able to really get down and ask some serious questions from people who are really, really clued in. And so I thought it'd be a nice opportunity. So we're going to take a break, sit back, get your hot cocoa and your slippers on. We're going to give you a gentle ride tonight. We'll be back right after the break. And we're back. And welcome to everybody. I just thought that tonight, you know, after all the stress and trauma of the last few weeks leading up to the 21st of December, that it would be nice to have a kind of relaxing show for a change and give you an opportunity to become involved, ask your questions. Tonight, I have with me, obviously, probably our most well-known guest, and that's William White Crow, and he's with us. But also, you got a little taste yesterday of who Zen Shaman really is, and I promised that I'd bring him back to you today. And we thought it would be fun to kind of do a round table. Might even manage to get Leanne involved as well, which might be kind of fun. I don't know. She might. I thought I'd give you the opportunity to talk to two shamans. Now, obviously, as you know, William White Crow comes from the Native American approach. And Bill, Zen Shaman, comes more from the Eastern approach. And so it's an opportunity to have two people here who explore very different avenues, but there are also some incredibly strong similarities. From my point of view, I've trained as a shaman. I've trained as a spiritual teacher for a good many years, more years than I care to think about. And so I think between us, we can probably bring you quite a nice show. So this is with the warmest of welcomes that I welcome William Whitecrow and Bill Zen Shaman. Good evening.
Good evening. How are you guys doing this evening?
We're doing good. Perhaps you'd like to give people a little bit of an explanation, William, on exactly where you come from, how you got into this. I imagine that you were pretty much born into it, but you obviously had to choose your own direction. So maybe you'd like to explain to people a little bit how you walked this pathway.
Well, basically, I started walking this pathway because as I grew up, I felt different. I didn't play with the normal kids and everything. I mean, I went out and had fun and everything like this and rode the bikes and went swimming, went partying as a youth and everything. But there was always something else inside of me that was pulling me in a different direction because really, even at a very young age, and we're talking 7, 8, 9, I didn't feel like I belonged. There was an imbalance I felt. And most of my life, I just wanted to find that balance. I really wanted to find out who I was because of the way I'd listen to elders talk and from many different cultures. And they would just look and say, when you get older, you'll understand more. Well, I wanted that knowledge early in a sense, you know. But I went hard times when I was young. And that really made me start searching for something that would bring me peace and understanding of what was going on in the world around me. And with my parents and things like this. And when I took off one day, I left home. I ran away, basically. And when I was in Weed, California, from the Indian reservation down south, that's a long distance, you know, from San Diego, its area, shall we say, to Weed, California, I questioned myself one day, that day on the road, and I said, where am I going? What am I doing? And I went back. Luckily, from that point on, I started being instructed by one individual and another that started me on this shamanic path. And then I met two individuals that really kind of took me under their wings and started teaching me the old ways, you know, the ceremonies. I had a chance to go down into the caves down in New Mexico and everything and go through the ceremonies there. Then I got a chance to travel around a little more in the United States, and I really listened. But I had that search. There was something missing inside me. And every time I desired something, shall we say, I wanted more, but more was never enough. And as we're all growing up, we experience this. We really do. And then one day, I really figured it out for myself. It was the aspect of wanting, of desiring things myself, which really didn't fit with me. I was a more of a go-with-the-flow type situation. And I always believed that the things I needed would come to me, and I didn't have to really worry about much in my life because I was really bound close to nature. I could go in the woods, and I never really knew I had this expertise of going in the woods and surviving until I went out and tried it. And then solitude came in my life and along with these elders, and life started changing. I started seriously searching who I was, what I was, where I came from, and it grew from there, really. That was the essence of how things started right there. It was, and I want to tell you all out there, if you come from very humble and bad beginnings, shall we say violence or drugs or any of this type of stuff, meditation helped me a lot. It helped me pull away. And people on the outskirts of my family, because we were a pretty violent crew in the early days. But as time grew on, I broke away from my normal scheme of things, that trend of violence and everything at a very young age. And started looking for myself and looking for those out there that could teach me the things that I needed to find. And luckily, as the Great Spirit would have it, and as my intuitive abilities kept growing, I found more and more and more of these people. Each and every one of you can go on this path at a moment's notice. You just have to make that decision because you control every aspect of your life. You may not think so, but you really do. You have to look inside and make those decisions.
Gotcha. We got a lot of ground that we're going to have to cover tonight. Bill, would you like to come on and give a little bit of background on how you ended up on your path? And I'll share a little bit about mine after.
Good evening, everybody. Can you hear me okay now?
We can hear you great.
All right.
Perfect.
You know, hello, William. It's good to talk to you. My story is very similar to yours, except I come from the other side of the world. I was born into this world, into an Arabic family. And I drowned at five is what happened. I had a drowning experience. And I lived an entire lifetime, an entire experience in another place. Mm-hmm. And I came back and, you know, I couldn't understand what was going on. I was only five, you know. And, you know, I tried to talk to my father about this and to my family and others, and this really disturbed them greatly and set me on a collision path with my father. And I was taken out. I ran away from home as well at 13 and spent the night. Yeah, it was a very violent situation. We really got into it pretty good. And I came to Colorado. Well, I was born here in Colorado, and I came back to Colorado to stay with my grandparents. And then I was so physically and emotionally traumatized at that point that they were looking for treatment for me, and they relinquished custody of me to the state. And I ended up going through group homes and so forth. And I ran away from the last one at 17 and joined the Navy. That was really the only way to get out. I was still a minor in the eyes of the state, and they were looking at me because I ran away from the last group home. So they were looking for me. So I joined the Navy, and that was my out. And I tried to put that drowning experience behind me over the years. You know, I had tried to talk about it, and people just, you know, didn't want to hear about it. I would, you know, tell them about my experience and things that I saw going on around me. I would have visions, and I would see things, and I was very precognitive. So I escaped to the Navy, and I served a few years there as a Navy corpsman, and then I got out and kicked around a bit. And as I was telling you, Tony, last night, I ran into this this really interesting guy named Ken Farley, and he was going around the country putting on these private, I don't know what you'd call them, classes. Apparently he was looking for me, because he stopped with me. But he put me through a very intensive series of trainings, and gosh, here I am today.
Mm-hmm. Very good. I understand that.
I don't know what else to say. It's a long, involved story, and
you know, really, Bill, it's kind of hard for us to turn around and say everything that we went through in our training, whether it was Eastern or Western philosophies, because, you know, you can't compact all the years of training and experiences, both spiritually and physically, that we go through in this process to get where we've gotten. So, you know, 5 or 10 minutes, that's kind of hard to do.
Let me share a little bit of my journey. And, you know, as time goes by, I come to realize that most of us have come down this path from a fairly rocky beginning, which I think is what inspires you to find something better. I mean, I didn't really question my life until I was about 32 years old. I was married. I had a couple of kids. I had a mortgage. I had all the usual stuff. And I was seeking more. I wanted more. Now, I was very fortunate in that I had somebody that I knew of who I was aware had certain skills and could do things. It was almost as if he was waiting for me to ask the question. Because when I asked the question, he said, okay, why don't you come down and visit with me for the weekend and we'll talk about it. Well, he took me down a pathway where, I mean, I learned the ancient ways, I learned ancient skills, and basically, it's got me to the point that I'm at now. Looking back, it's hard to remember what it was like when I knew nothing. But I suppose I was a bit of a late starter. But it's not uncommon. A lot of us don't really call into question until we're in our 30s, sometimes 40s. And so I guess, you know, unless you're born into it in some way, I didn't have that privilege. But I had someone there who was literally waiting for me to ask the right questions. And the journey that it took me on was, to put it mildly, totally life-changing. Has resulted in me living in America, has involved me in, you know, living down in the Maya lands, traveling, backpacking around the Yucatan, and getting involved in other things that were inspiring. But really, the Maya were just a spin-off for me of really the main pathway that I was on. I mean, I've always had abilities. I've always had skills. I've always been able to do things that are as natural to me as breathing. And my biggest shock in my life was when I realized that other people couldn't do what I could do. I mean, I'm a healer. I've been a spiritual teacher. But I used to do that, you know, I used to do healing when I was totally untrained. If my kids had a grazed knee or a headache or something like that, I would teach them to ball it up. And I would place my hand up over the top of it. And I would literally take that pain from them and cast it away. I've always been able to do that. I've been able to do it with myself. And I thought everybody could do this, and they can't. And so that really is the secondary purpose of this show tonight. Mm-hmm. It's not about how wonderful we are and how wonderful it is to be us having walked down this pathway, but to help other people to get up onto this pathway, find the right person who's going to be able to help them, steer them in the right direction, what is a healthy direction to go in and what is an unhealthy direction to go in. You know, and the opportunity, I wanted to be able to give the listenership the opportunity to be able to talk with us directly from our different perspectives. And you know, that's why I thought this show tonight would be kind of gentle, kind of fun, and give people really what they're looking for. So, got any comments, guys?
How about you, Bill?
Go ahead, William.
No, you know, I was just thinking about all the, you know, Bill explained his, I explained mine, Bill and you. The similarity is in here that we had a need. You know, we knew things weren't right. We knew that there was something different, something else that we needed to be doing. The training that I know all of us went through from all different types of people, different backgrounds, seemed to be converging all in one area. And that's to teach us balance, what it is, to understand what desire is, understand who and what we are, and that search of what are we looking for in the future. And, but one thing I know about each and every one of us, we've had that ability to heal at a very young age. We didn't know that it was not normal. So others might have looked at us, what are you crazy? You doing that for? No, I've had people walk in my store, say they have a sore arm or this and that, and able to work with them and then teach them how to do the same thing. But in order to get to these points, I had to pull myself away from this, what we call real world, and go into the real world of self-discovery and understanding.
I agree with that. You know, for me, it's been a process of remembering and unfolding. One thing, you know, what was key in my training was body training. I started at a young age, beginning really at five. Everything for me began really at five. And I was doing conscious meditation and physical discipline exercises from the age of five on. And I, like you, I thought this was normal. You know, I had just come from a place where everything is alive. You know, I was contemplating it earlier. It's to describe it, it's almost like the internet. You have a consciousness, an overall consciousness that is there, but yet what makes that overall consciousness? Well, it's a whole bunch of computers tied together. Well, that's what it was like for me. Yeah, I shared this consciousness. Yet I was still an individual. If it makes sense to you, but I don't know if it makes sense to others. Yes. So, and once you touch that, you know, you're never the same. I didn't set out to become Zen or shaman or go down this road. It called me. Mm-hmm. I didn't even realize I was a shaman until just a couple of years ago. It finally occurred to me. Oh man, I'm shaman. And, you know, I'm still trying to come to terms with that. I've been very private about this. I've been very hidden. I've been searching quietly in my own way. I work with students individually on a very personal level that way. Yes. And, you know, for me, getting on the radio and talking about this and even having a website and beginning to present this material.
Yeah, well, we're about 25 seconds out from the break, so
why don't you guys take over?
Yeah, we'll give you a chance to sort your communications out. You know, there are a lot of aspects we want to cover. I want people to understand when you take this journey on, it's a major undertaking, and we're going to discuss that next. So we'll be back right after the break. Okie dokie, see you in a few. And we're back, and this is Beyond 2012, Tony Kudos, covering for Chris and Cherie, who are off on their travels. So if you've just joined us, we have, it's the Bill and Bill Show. It's William Whitecrow, and it's Bill, who you know as Zen Shaman. And we're talking about shamanism. We're talking about spirituality, how you actually get into it. And one of the things that I really wanted to cover, and it's a subject that people who have already gone down this pathway very often don't bring to light. But when you take these steps, it's a bit like taking the red pill. There is no going back. You cannot go back to where you were before you knew anything. It is a commitment. It's a blessing, but it's also a huge responsibility. Because when you start to walk this pathway, it's not just your life that's being affected, but it's you're affecting the lives of people around you beneficially and very strongly, but it changes completely your world attitude, your view of life, how you perceive your world. And remember that your worldview is different to everybody else's. And as my mentor said to me, there is only one real commonality that we all share, and that is that we all see the sun come up and we all see the sun go down. But beyond that, everybody's view of their world is different, totally different. I mean, you can even prove it to yourself. Look at something, cover one eye and look at a color, and then cover the other eye and you see it as a slightly different color. It might be a subtle difference, but imagine looking at the world through somebody else's eyes and how they filter their world. And we are a product of our experiences. That's well-established truth. And so somebody else is filtering their world through their set of filters, which are different to yours. So yeah, let's explore really what it's like to actually take this journey and make that commitment, and really how it changes everything. Would you like to fill in some of those blanks for me, William?
Yeah, you know, I know that we'll all agree, Tony and Bill and myself, on this. You know, this road really isn't an easy road, because we really have the thoughts and the health of other people to think about, you know. And if we're teaching this, and I do have students everywhere, we really have to look at their mindset, where they're at that time. But the life of a shaman is not an easy one. You know, you don't go out and get riches and everything like this. Most of us have very little money, and that money that we do get, we end up helping other people with. But the training you have to go through, a lot of solitude, a lot of meditation, a lot of deep contemplation, but also there's a lot of looking at society and the world in a completely different way. We have to look at what is going on out there with our students, with ourselves, with the world as an observer. This way we do not get caught up in all of the emotional drama and all of the headaches, because now we're looking at this with there is an emotional content. I can't explain it exactly. You have to experience it. And that is a big part of the shamanic studies. You just can't sit and read a book. You have to experience yourself, each and everything. The herbal cures that I use with cancer patients, leukemia patients, mentally ill patients, all, any kind of patient, and I've worked with them all, really depends a lot on the complete aspect of who and what they are. So we have to really look at a deeper level of what's going on. But the key here is you see the world as it really is. And Tony, I really like the way you put that, what pill you took. Because once you take this one pill and you wake up, that's it. You can never close those eyes again. You really see what's going on, and you have to work within those realities, those dimensions. Tensions with people's desires, with their likes, their hates, and sometimes the simple fact of illness is we've brought on ourselves by emotional chaos going on within us.
How about you, Bill?
I agree with everything you just said, and I'll just add to that. I know that one thing that I am constantly striving for is balance. That is my main focus, is balance in everything. As a shaman, I know that that's our main focus. And I noticed a question here in the chat room: what dangerous experiences have the guests had with being a shaman? Many things come to mind. But I, let me tell you what the greatest danger is in my experience from what I've seen. Many people, you know, there's been a fad since, off and on throughout history, but lately this began roughly in the 60s, with people looking to explore their, you had training like EST, extra sensitivity training. We all remember that. Oh, you had all these psychic classes going on, people moving into this and becoming aware of this and wanting to learn this. Well, without the proper foundation, going into something like remote viewing or astral traveling or going into some of these shamanic experiences, you know, I notice a trend a lot with the younger people, wanting to experiment with some of these, entheogenics. And, you know, I really question that. There's got to be a very solid foundation before going into these things because it will drive you mad. And I have witnessed this in several people. They will start playing with some of these tools that do not have the proper foundation, and they'll drive themselves mad. So that's the greatest danger that I see, is people playing with the idea of knowledge, ascension, whatever term an individual uses to call that experience. It's not a game. It's very real. And yeah. That's the way I see that, yeah.
The point I would make is you wouldn't take yourself out to a 400-foot rock face with a piece of rope and start climbing around and rappelling down without being taught how to tie the knots properly, how to use a carabiner, how to use a harness properly, how to secure yourself to the rock face. And it's a bit like this. You can't learn how to climb a rock from a book. You got to go do it. You've got to go graze your knees. You've got to go get blisters on your fingers, and you've got to do it for real. But it's also vitally important that you have somebody train you properly. There are dangers to this. Let me outline some of the dangers. I knew somebody who desperately wanted to join a witch's coven. That was her intention. She made it very clear. That was what she wanted to do. And ultimately, she got invited into a coven. I saw her 6 months later, and she looked haunted. I've never seen somebody look so scared in all my life. And it changed her. She made a bad decision. She made a wrong decision, and she got in with the wrong people. And so the choice of your path is very important. These are things not to be messed with. These are things not to be undertaken lightly. But equally, I've worked with a lot of students. I've also trained a lot of teachers. But what I always used to question, do you need to protect yourself when you first start out? Do you need to know how to ground yourself, how to seal out extraneous forces that may be inappropriate? The thing is, when you first take this path, you are very open. And you don't know what the warning signs are, and you don't know what the challenges are at that juncture. And so, yes, when you first start, it's important to learn how to ground yourself, how to protect yourself, and how to advance forward. That is vital. There comes a point when you're sufficiently well trained where you don't need that, because you know the things that you should be looking for. And it's, again, a bit like climbing a rock face. And when you first do it, you do it with a safety line on, as well as your main climbing rope. But laterally, you can free climb. Laterally, you can rappel down a rock face because you know how to do it. You know you're safe. You know you're secure. And I think that's probably a half-decent analogy. What say you, William?
I have to agree with you. And the reason I say that is I've watched when as soon as Bill brought up about going insane, I had a little chuckle there. I know you heard it, Bill. And because I've seen people, as we say, get lost in the spirit world. Okay, they get so – and this is a perfect example, you know, the end of the world scenario of 2012. How many people were going to these sacred sites expecting the end of the world? Well, if they would have understood, instead of following others – you know, we're looking at an ego issue here, okay? People following others, they make you feel good, and then to drag you right down into the depths of the canyon, you fall off the cliff, off the face of the cliff, as you're talking about. Well, your teachers are the ones that really are your rope. or they're your carabiners, they're your, you know, the rock holding you there, yeah, everything to you, until you really understand yourself and how you're going to react to different situations and understand what your balance is, your true balance within yourself and what you can handle, you better have that lifeline, because things can get real deep real quick and you don't even know what's happening. There was times when I was confused in training. Well, you know, what do you mean by this? Because I took it as a completely different way and one thing or another. And they brought me back around. They threw that little floater out there with the rope, pulled me back in with the knowledge that they had. But, you know, Tony, it goes right back to what I had said to begin with. You know, this isn't something that you read in a book or watch in a movie or a video. Becoming a medicine man or woman or a shaman, you have to go through the experiences of the, let's say, herbs. If you're working with herbs, you better know those herbs. You're going to kill somebody. You're going to make them sick, or they might have a reaction. You have to learn how to use these things in the right way, or you're going to harm somebody. And that's the last thing that any of us would ever want to do.
That's right. Bill, you're aware there's a question in chat. So what I'm going to do, I'll let you handle this one, Bill. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to let Leanne field the questions in chat and bring them to us. So it'll help us to stay a little bit more focused, because we're going to start to get really deep in this show. So I'm going to let Leanne field all of those. So over to you, Bill.
Sounds good. You know, I agree with everything, needless to say, what you guys just said. My perspective has, and it, since the beginning, has been body control, mind control, self-control. That's been a very, very big part of my training and my philosophy. Know yourself and you will know your creator. In fact, before I even ever take anybody out on journeys or even show anyone how to do that, much time is spent, you know, you need to know yourself. You've got to know yourself. It's a big ocean. The universe is a big ocean out there, full of a lot of life. And for the most part, you know, life is good. But just like the ocean, there's things swimming around out there that can and will eat you. And you've got to have a grounding perspective as far as that goes. So my focus has always been on body, on breath, on connection to our Mother Earth, whom I have seen in visions, and I know to be true that we are the living expression of her DNA consciousness. We resonate at the same frequency as she does. And that's my perspective from there. Now, I noticed that the chat had a question here on evil, and do I believe evil to be an external malignant force or being manifested in the human psyche, a human act? All three, maybe, and our thoughts on possession. Personally, for a long time, I refused to acknowledge the presence of evil. I didn't want to deal with it, didn't want to look at it, didn't want to have anything to do with it. As my awareness has grown and my remembrance has grown, yes, there is an evil presence here. And yes, you know, we've talked about this over the centuries, the shaman have. We've called them archons. We've called them a lot of different names. The fact of it comes down to this, it is a living being. It is inorganic in the sense that it is pure intelligence, but it has no soul and it has no emotion. And yes, this thing is a master of psychic warfare, and it does and can and will. It does take over bodies. It does take over human psyches. Yes. And right now I know this, that there are many shamans and many others that are locked in a duel with this thing at this point in time, and we're winning.
One of the points I'd like to make out of that, I've done some extremely deep and far out meditations in my time. And what I did in the security of being surrounded by a lot of other people who are like-minded, I went out and explored the boundaries of what I could do. And yeah, I touched the edge of the, what you would call the dark side. And I did it deliberately, and I touched it in many places. And there was a very sound reason for doing that, even though a lot of people in the circle thought it wasn't a good idea. I decided that it was important to know where that boundary was, because it's a very subtle boundary. And it's easy to cross if you cross that boundary without being aware that you did it. So I went out in a particular meditation and really explored that. So I knew where it was. I knew where my safe limits were and established those relatively quickly. As I said at the beginning, when you first start exploring this, and this isn't like prayer, this is something radically different, folks. It's important that you, when you start out, are taught how to protect yourself. And another thing that I want to draw to your attention. Now, I don't have an issue with people charging for healing. And I've also proven that if somebody pays for it, because we live in a material world, that if somebody pays for it, that it actually is more efficacious because they've actually literally bought into it. They've made a commitment to it. And sadly, in this world of ours, something that you get for free is deemed as having little or no value. When I teach someone, I work with them very intensely for 6 months, and there is no charge involved at all. And it's as much a commitment from me as it is a commitment from my student. But their undertaking is this, that once they have learned that if somebody else genuinely comes to them with the desire to learn, they have to give the time and the commitment to that person exactly as I gave to them. Now, you say, well, you know, how does this work? Well, if I teach six people, and those six people teach another six people, and those that they teach teach another six people, that is how it spreads. But beware of those that want to charge you serious amounts of money to teach you how to emulate them. We're in a time of quickening right now. We're in a time of awareness right now. And a lot of people are seeking something with greater substance than the material world. And there are a lot of people out there who are ready to exploit that. And so, you know, follow the money, be aware that, you know, a lot of people out there are just seeking to make themselves feel good, to make a very good living out of it. And really, this is a gift. This is a gift that you are given by the teacher or the shaman or the facilitator that you're working with. And it's one way that you can gauge it. Sure, if they have to travel to you and they have, you know, they have the cost of gasoline and everything else, and you make a love offering, a contribution to that person, that's different. But if somebody wants to charge you a substantial amount of money to teach you this stuff, it's very much a case of buyer beware. We still got about 7 minutes to go. What do you say to that, William?
Well, basically, I have to agree with you. I accept gifts. I don't take them myself. My wife has to take that thing, because if I'm doing a ceremony or something like this for somebody, for protection, for helping them rebalance themselves, I can't take anything for that. And you're right that the modern society nowadays is all set up to do exactly that. You know, you get something for nothing is what a lot of people think when somebody is trying to help you and they don't charge for that. Well, don't believe that. There are a lot of people out there that will charge you exorbitant amounts of cash for doing something that actually you can do yourself once you understand your own principles of balance and what's working or not working in your mind and your heart. Yeah, I have to say you have to be very careful.
Bill, what do you have to say to that, Bill?
You know, I go back and forth on that myself. There are some who, I've seen both arguments. No, don't charge for it. Yes, charge for it. There has to be a value placed on everything. Yes, there is a universal capitalism that exchange places. There's always an exchange of energy for something. My approach has always been commitment. What's your level of heart? Listen, this is a brutal process. Getting to know yourself and being, learning to be honest, subduing your ego, slaying it, making it your, being the master of yourself is not easy. This is hard. This is very hard, and it takes a commitment. I don't charge money, but I charge a commitment. You know, you've got to be serious about this. And yeah, it's, I charge a commitment. That's what I charge.
Gotcha. Now I promised faithfully that we would field questions as they came in through the chat room. Anybody that wants to put a question in, please proceed your comment with question. We will address the question. Actually, it's just popped up on my screen, so I'm gonna field this. So the question is this: resonating at what frequency could a 432 hertz be optimal tuning for all living things on and off world? So I'm going to throw that over to you, William. I don't kind of do the frequency thing. I don't know whether you do.
Well, basically, the frequency thing, you know, we're talking about resonance, about body frequencies, about frequencies that work together. It's kind of like a magnetism for you people out there. That I know some people don't get as deep as we do, but, you know, you have a positive and a negative polarity. Well, when you put a positive polarity here and a negative, they'll pull together. You put the same polarities and they push away from one another. In our world and what we do and everything, this is a very important fact that we have to look at. You know, our bodies do resonate at a good frequency through meditations and things of this nature. These frequencies can be, we can learn to control these things within ourselves, so that our frequency that is working with the planet, with the healing individual. Now, this is a thing that a lot of people don't look into. This individual that might be sick, their frequency is low. We have to bring that back up by using other means that work for them to bring it back up, bring the body back into balance, meaning bringing it back up to the frequency, its optimal frequency, for it to be healthy. Now, whether that's a 432, I've never really delved into that, but what I was taught, that these frequencies have to be raised to the point where the rest of those universal energies are working in harmony with that particular individual's frequency. And that's how we stay healthy, happy, and everything else.
Bill, would you like to feed in on that one?
Sure. In my perspective, I view and I experience frequency as a song. Being a song, how I envision everything. An optimal frequency, I don't see an optimal frequency, no. What I see is a harmonic balance. You always want to sing in harmony. Find your own song. What resonates with you? That's where knowing yourself comes in. We have an overall frequency that we resonate. Sure, we do. But we also have an inner frequency that we resonate. There's different parts of us. As human beings, our consciousness is bifurcated, so to speak. There's different parts of us. I've identified myself approximately three parts. My quest, my goal, as I said, is always balance. So what I do is I don't choose any particular frequency. I listen to the song being sung, and I adjust my song to that song.
Yeah, I'm going to talk about frequency a bit. I never go to a particular specific frequency. When you start out, when anybody starts out, you're generally not resonating, not vibrating at as high a level as you can be. And I'll go through that and I'll do my best to explain in an overall view what chakras are all about. But as you develop, your individual chakras tend to be out of balance. They tend to be blocked. They tend to be clogged for a whole range of reasons. And your whole body is out of balance. I don't care how fit you are. I don't care how well you eat. I don't care whatever it is. When somebody starts out, they are out of balance pretty badly. And first of all, it's a matter of getting them into some kind of harmonic through their body. Now, it may be a low frequency, and it's a matter of stepping them gradually up to a higher frequency and dealing with the blockages and dealing with the imbalances of the chakras. That's something that we're going to come back and revisit later on. But what we're going to open with in the next phase is a question that just about everybody asks. And that is this: what is meditation? Is it prayer? Is it this? Is it that? We're going to look at that when we come back. We're going to take a little time while we're taking the break and work out how we're going to discuss that. But that's really what I'd like to address, because it's fundamental. What is meditation? And we're going to do our best to try and explain to you all what it means to us, and I'm sure you're going to get three totally different perspectives on this, but you're also going to see a lot of commonalities. And when used properly and used wisely, it's a very, very, very powerful tool for both the beginner and the shaman alike. And it's something that we all do, and you can actually live your entire day in meditation. Nobody would ever notice. Nobody would ever know. So we'll try and shine some light on that and really ask that eternal question. And I hope that's going to help. Keep the questions coming in, folks. We're going to try and address them as best we can. Please try and keep them in context so you don't take us down bunny trails. But we will do our best to address all of the questions that you have. We're about to take a break, so be back in a few. And we're back. This is Tony Kudos with William Whitecrow and Bill Zen Shaman. We're going to address the question that I've often been asked, and I'm sure all three of us have been asked. What is meditation? Is it prayer? Prayer can be considered to be a form of meditation. It depends on the particular religious pathway that you've followed. To me, it's different. I've explored regular religion. I chose to be baptized by my own choice at 18 years old. But the regular church just wasn't a fit for me. There were too many unanswered questions, and nobody could answer those questions for me. I then started looking in lots of different directions, and ultimately I was trained. I was trained in ancient ways, which fitted with me. It was a perfect fit. It was a perfect fitting glove. And then I began to understand meditation. And meditation to me is far, far beyond prayer. And it's more than just laying somewhere quiet and just thinking. No. A constant battle for my students has been the battle with their own ego. And my students call their ego the rat. Because the ego is always trying to rationalize everything that happens. And once you start to develop in your meditation and you can communicate directly with your own soul and you ask a question, you always get two answers. You get the first answer, which is absolute truth, direct from your own soul. It's what is referred to in Christianity as the still small voice within. And that's what it is. And you have to be real quiet to hear and understand it. It's a matter, really, of putting yourself into a slightly altered state. It's extremely comfortable, where you can start to explore yourself, explore your soul. And the second answer that you get in that scenario is your ego, your id, trying to rationalize what just happened. Because your ego is what grounds you to this plane. And your ego is what tries always to take control of the situation and make sense of it. And remember that we are souls here and we are bound to this plane. And that is the purpose of the exercise. And a little later on, I'm going to try and explain to you all where I come from and the ancient teaching that I was given, which I hope is going to work for you. This is the short, very short segment. So immediately we come back, I'm going to pass it to William. He's going to talk about meditation. So sit tight, get comfortable. We'll be right back after the break. And we're back, and this is Beyond 2012, Tony Kudos, with William Whitecrow and Bill, who you know as Zen Shaman. And before the break, we started to talk about meditation and what it actually means. And so I kind of did a little bit of an opener to try and explain it. But I'm going to pass straight across to William, and William's going to put his definition to what meditation is. So over to you, William.
You know, Tony, when you were given that information on meditation there, and you said you're going to hear three different versions. If we ask everybody out there that deals with meditation, you're going to have 100 different versions. And we know that because I've heard them myself. Meditation And to me, what I was doing is taking ourselves to a different level of understanding. It's, we kind of get in a zone where we actually, I like the statement, you could be in meditation all day long that you had said, Tony, and nobody would know it, because that is the case. I've done it. I observe everything's going on. I feel everything at a different level. When I meditate on a subject, let's talk about what in Christianity, they talk about meditating on the word of God. Okay, now they're meditating on these words that are trying to enlighten them into aspects of ourselves, of what we've done, what we do, who we are. You know, we've went over this several times before, but meditating to me, particular, is putting myself in a higher state of consciousness. We're becoming the observer of my internal self, of my physical self, and the world around me. And I like what you said about getting two answers when you ask something in meditation, because it's true. The first one is your absolute truth that I've always ran into, and it's been 100% every single time. Now, all of us have had those points of time in our life where we turn around and we say, well, I need to do this. And that little voice comes in your head, says, no, you don't. Something's going to happen. But you override that and you go ahead because you listen to the other answer. Well, that's a perfect example of what meditation is to me. If I ask a question, I get answers on a regular basis. But these answers are really coming from a deeper source of self, being in tune and in balance what's going on within you and the world around you allows us to take ourselves in these meditative states to different levels. You talked about touching evil in your meditations and darkness at one time, and I have to agree with Bill. There is darkness. There is a deep, very powerful evil out there. You can look at the world and see what's going on. And it is up to us in our meditations to find our limits. And this is what we can do in meditation. We can reach out there and touch things. But then we have to go back to the very first things that we talked about here. Make sure that your teacher understands where you're at. You know in your heart where you're ready. Try not to go too deep, because then you can get lost in these meditations and let the ego take over. With this, in meditations, you put the ego aside. That is the key there. You're looking at yourself and everything in a much deeper, profound level of awareness of what's going on. And you see and hear things totally different in meditation, because that's where the truths are. This is, you could say search mode on a computer. You type something in, computer goes right to it. Well, in deep meditation and in your average meditations, when you understand how to do it right, this is where you go. And you go first in your meditations, the way I have done it, is through your breathing patterns, learning different breathing patterns, which brings us into different frequencies, which we were talking about earlier, and also physical aspects of ourselves, postures. There's many different ways to do these meditations, like in the Eastern philosophies. I know Bill will touch on that. But and that's wrong. That's about what I have to say, because meditation, I really believe, for each individual is different. And how it affects me and how I went into it through breathing exercises. And then I had to listen to my heart. I had to keep my mind, learn how to still my mind. That's the best way to put it, and empty it. And when I got to those points, then meditation blossomed like the lotus blossom or a rose petal. It just opened up so many different positive areas of understanding in my life that it was just amazing. Go ahead, Bill. How about you?
Brother William, you said it exactly. I would do a disservice to try to say anything. You captured it wonderfully. It is all about getting in touch with yourself, getting in touch with your surroundings, and remaining there. I began the very same way. It began with breath. It began with body control. Depending on the intent, what your intent is going into the meditation, you know, there's different techniques of, you know, that one can use. There's guided meditations. There's different meditations where, well, for example, when I teach someone to begin to open up their chakras and to begin using some of their inborn extrasensory powers, what I do is we focus on breath. And what I do is I teach people to see with their eyes closed. And I have different techniques that I use for that. But it really depends on what the outcome will be. But it all begins with breath, with the frequency, and going to that inner place inside. And I'll tell you, once you find how to get to that spot, there are worlds within each of us. There are realities. There are, be an explorer, folks. Know yourself. There is so much that is inside of you that so many people just never touch. And I watch these people, you know, I hear a lot of terms for these people, you know, sheeple, zombies, oh, this, that, oh, making fun of them for sleepwalking their life away. Well, listen, folks, there's a time for sleep and there's a time for being awake. And who are we to judge or to tell somebody, wake up? You know, what we're really doing is saying, hey, we're in a really bad situation. Well, for example, in our country right now, I hear, you know, a lot of different talk shows and people ranting, oh, why won't people wake up? And, oh, we got to do this to wake people up and that. And I'm sitting here thinking to myself, man, listen, when you're in a deep sleep, the last thing you want is to somebody to come around and stir you out of a deep slumber, which you needed the rest. Obviously, you're sleeping. And this fool came along and shook you awake and told you the roof of your house is on fire. Now, what kind of way is that to wake up? Listen, this path is a very individual path. There is no one answer for anybody. And when you look for a teacher and you're looking to the universe to find these answers, that is the first thing you need to look for. Is this person going to teach me how to find myself? That's the question that you need to ask.
Let me share something personal. I mean, life throws us all spin balls. Life can throw us some very, very, very difficult pathways. And yeah, as I've gone through my life, I've gone through situations where I've been very blue, very unhappy, bordering on depression, you know, for various stages I was going through in my life. And let me tell you how powerful meditation really is. You can go to a doctor, and the doctor is going to give you a handful of pills. And those pills may serve to break up the cloud, but it doesn't make the cloud go away. And the one thing that I found with meditation is, one, it's helped to get me through the bad times, the really tough emotional times. It's helped to keep me away from the depths of depression. It turned my life around, guys and gals. For me, it gave me the way to understand my life and to see it in a different perspective. And indeed, where I saw that the things that were happening in my life were betrayals, after this, I realized that they weren't betrayals at all, but it gave me a way of looking at my life and understanding the path that I was being steered down. And it radically changed my life. And it can do the same for you. And I'm not going to tell you that this is the only way of doing it. There are many, many different pathways. And if you consider that we all start on the outside of a wooden cartwheel and we're headed in towards the hub, it doesn't matter which spoke you choose to go down. The closer that you get to the hub, the more you realize that all of the pathways are extremely similar at that point. Now, a little later on, I'm going to share something that I consider to be very special, and it's some very ancient wisdom that comes from the time of the Greeks, and I'm going to share that with you, and it will help to put things into perspective. There is no one path to get to the destination that you seek on your journey, and this life is not a destination. This life is a journey. The destination is when you leave this plane and what you've learned when you've been here. But I will share it with you later on. I hope you'll put up with me sharing it, but I think you're going to find it interesting. And the wonderful thing about it is it doesn't actually conflict with anybody's faith system that they follow. So I'm going to pass it back to you, William.
You know, Tony, I like what Bill was saying just right there. You know, the sheeple. I've used that term. And don't worry, Bill. I'm not going to attack you here. Yeah, I'm not that way. I use this technique, and this is how I was brought into this reality concept. concept of who I was, what I was, because a lot of these terms were used with me when I was first learning to wake me up to what was really going on in the world around me. And once I'm going, oh my God, the world is going to end. What am I going to do? Oh yeah. And chaos is raining. The first thing that happened was this. My elders looked at me and smiled and said, you went for the oldest trick in the book here. What you need to do is recenter yourself. He says, you have to understand that there's a man aspect of us, and Tony and Bill will agree to this, and then there's the medicine or shaman aspect of us. I've got the ability to step out of this shaman aspect, because we did a show on this, and show you just what man does. Then I can go into the shaman aspect of it, and look at it totally from a different way, from the shaman point of view. Now, a good teacher should be able to show you these different aspects of yourself. And however they do it, that is totally up to them. But people do use those terms as shock treatment to wake people up. But once they're awake, realizing, oh my God, what's going on? Then you can grab them because you have their attention. And you can pull them back in and say, okay, now you really know what's happening in the world. Now you feel all these weird feelings. Doesn't it feel strange? You're not in balance. And then you can start working with a student or an individual like clay, because this is all any of us are. We're just a giant lump of clay, and we have to be molded into what we are today. And sometimes we have to mold something, then crush it up again and warm that clay up again with the right teachings and the right spiritual awareness of who we are and our balance and what's going on in the world and how this world affects us. Because in meditation, you can literally not let anything affect you once you understand its aspects and the power that it has to you. And this really, and Tony, you made a point there, that it doesn't have anything to do with any particular belief system or religion. This is something that shamans from all aboriginal peoples and belief systems use to better themselves and their understanding of what's really going on within themselves and the world around them. And the energies of the planet and the plants and the animals and everything, you know, we're living out of balance. Our planet is right now. But the people, each and every one of us, are slowly starting to come full circle and understand that, wow, we are out of balance. What can we do to fix this? So we're starting at the personal level, working to our friends and everything. Then we work to a local level. And that's how we heal things, ourselves and the world, our friends, everything.
Over to you, Bill.
Exactly right, brother. That is exactly right. And, you know, there is occasion where you really got to shake somebody. And, you know, I was a Zen Buddhist monk for many years. And one of my favorite stories was there was an old Zen teacher, oh, I think around the 600s or so. And his approach to teaching his students was to hit them on the head with a cane. And what was so amazing about this man was he had the highest success rate of his students reaching enlightenment, but the poor man never had very many students. I do understand the concept, and I've tried both ways. My approach now, as has been shown to me, is and made abundantly clear, is love and compassion and understanding. And very rarely will I shake somebody unless they're just really in the depths of despair and really, really in trouble. My strength, where my approach is to touch somebody's heart, and at least I plant a seed. And that's kind of my approach. I really approach this with a Zen approach.
Hey, want to address a question that came in from the room, and it's a very important question, and it goes back to something I said earlier. And that is, how does one find a reputable shaman in their area? I would say, first of all, at least have an idea what particular pathway you feel is going to fit with you. And if you find an egotistical shaman who says, mine is the only way, and if you go to anyone else, you're wasting your time, step away from that person and run as fast as you can. Anybody who can really justify calling themselves a shaman will be delighted that you approach them and that you start asking the right kind of questions. And, you know, there's an open understanding that you're searching. It took me probably a dozen different attempts before I found something that really fitted with me. And yes, there is a difference between a shaman and a guru. So you may find that you're drawn towards the Eastern approach, Native American, some Western approach, some other form of yoga, or that's the name of my dog. You've got to find what's going to fit with you, and that's what's important. So do a little research, as you would with anything, first of all. And another thing that I want to touch on is the use of where people use drugs to develop as shaman. I don't believe you need to do that, because as you develop, there is no need to actually use an entheogen of any kind. But that's my personal viewpoint. Later on, as you're developed and you can approach it properly, then maybe there comes a time when to take it to a different level, the use of drugs helps. I'm not an advocate of that. I've got to where I am without taking drugs at all. That is my belief, but that doesn't mean to say that that's right for everybody. So when we come back, I'm going to share with you a piece of ancient wisdom that I was given when I started out. And I hope you'll, you know, sit back, listen to it, see how it resonates with you. So I'll share that with you when we come back from the break. And I hope you enjoy that, because I found it helped me an awful lot in the understanding of who we are, why we're here, our purpose for life. So we'll share that. Be back in a few. And we're back with you again. This is Tony Kudos, covering for Chris and Cherie, who are off on their honeymoon, I guess. I guess that's what you call it. We've got William Whitecrow, and we have Bill, who you know as Zen Shaman. Please keep the questions coming. We're going to address those as they arise, or as rapidly as we can. Please keep them coming in. It's a golden opportunity for you to ask questions of three people who are following a shamanic pathway down slightly different routes, but and with different perspectives. But I said I'd give you the opportunity to share something that's very close to my heart. And it was something that I was taught right at the beginning of my own particular journey. And so I hope you'll sit back and bear with me on this. And I'll walk you through, and hopefully it will make sense and it will resonate with you. For the purpose only of convenience, I'm going to use the word God with a small g, but please fit into that gap the word that works for you. Great White Spirit, Creator, Supreme Consciousness, God with a large g, really whatever works for you. And it's only for convenience for me to put this concept across. And this comes from the times of the Greeks. It actually comes from the Pythagorean mystery school way back then. And so I'd like to share it with you. So, God exists in absolute perfection. God is absolute perfection. And one day, God realized that to understand perfection perfectly, it was also essential to understand imperfection perfectly. And so God considered this, and to that end, it created this plane and others in which it could explore and explain and understand imperfection. And for it to work, God had to divide itself up into parts. Notice I don't give God a gender. It's a bit like smashing a hologram, where when you smash it, every single fragment holds the complete image of that hologram. Now, those fragments of God are what we know and what we refer to as a soul. And so these souls manifested on various different planes, but they had to be able to interact with this plane and interact together in the realms of imperfection. And so in the case of us, we adopt a human form, we adopt a solid form in which our soul resides, But our body essentially runs on automatics. And the automatics that we use are run by what most of us would refer to as ego. And that body is what keeps us grounded to the plane that you're on. But of course, for this to work, God had to essentially forget that it was God, or it would simply have created perfection. Now, when souls manifest on this plane, they pass through what the ancients refer to as the veil of unknowing. And for some, that veil of unknowing is as thin as tissue paper. And for others, it's like a 10-foot thick block of steel-reinforced concrete that they will never penetrate. And that explains many aspects. Now, the entire event happened literally in the blink of an eye on a cosmic scale. But we exist in what is essentially a time bubble, a period of stretched time. So the whole event happened in an extremely short period of time. But it explains a lot of things. Like, for example, when somebody nearly drowns and they talk about their entire life rewinding like a movie, and really this, when we return back to the source, however you consider that to be, we carry back the message of imperfection that we learned on this plane and others and carry it back as a message back to the source. Now, that in essence, there's more to it, but I wanted to keep it fairly simple. But I have never found that it's really clashed with anybody's faith system, no matter what it is. And it explains our purpose for being here. But here's the important thing to remember. In this realm of imperfection, there is no right, there is no wrong, there is only that which is. And as the Maya have a greeting, the Mayan greeting you may have heard is in Lakesh, which means in you, I see another myself. If you take it to a different level, it's my heart to your heart to my heart. We are all here, each and every one of us, as manifestations of God. Don't cast judgment on your fellow man who's standing at the side of the road, holding out his hand for loose change for a meal. Be grateful for the fact that that soul is taking that particular journey, that particular lesson, and that you don't have to do that. Everybody here on this plane is of equal value. We all come here to learn a lesson, and there are around about 12 main lessons that we come to learn, but there are many, many, many permutations of each lesson. And you are born here to parents and a set of circumstances to teach you the lessons that you came to learn. And, you know, if you were going to learn what it was like to live in poverty and hunger, bordering on starvation, you probably wouldn't be born into Los Angeles, for example. You would probably be born into a third world country somewhere. But every soul manifesting here is on a journey, as you are all on a journey. And depending on the type of journey that you want to take and how involved you want to become in that journey, I hope the message that I just shared with you helps to give a little more meaning. I'm going to pass the mic over to William.
You know, Tony, exactly what you're saying, exactly what all of us believe. Once you become at this level of understanding as a shaman, you do understand that we're here for a reason. And it isn't the reason that you might hear in a church or anywhere else. You know, when you get down to the basics of shaman, I'm not attacking any belief system at all. I'm just saying because I was a minister and I had to do that to get into jails to help people, but it was a different set of rules. It was more the political aspects. What you're talking about right here is before we came to this world, we knew we were pure energy spirits. And this is how I've been taught. We're pure energy spirits. We have always been. We always will. We never die. What we chose to do because we were spirits is to come into this world and experience the physicality of this world, the happinesses, the sorrows, the pains, the jealousies, the hurts, the blessings, every aspect of this what we can. And then we turn around. When we go back, we have all these experiences. and therefore it adds to our knowledge base. We live many times, and I've been taught this. This is the way I look at it, and I understand this to be true, because before we come here, we choose the parents we're going to be with. So we manifest ourselves as a child through two parents, which we knew on the other side, these spirits anyway. And it's just kind of a never-ending cycle of allowing spirits to come into this world, experience this world, and go back with a higher level of understanding of what is going on. Because if you're not a physical being, you can't understand what the physical aspects are. Like you said, God needed to understand imperfections as well. And that's what we go through in this realm that we live in right now. I've learned from personal experience that many souls are special souls when they come here. They don't have to stay long because they've really experienced most everything that they needed to do. And they come here to help wake up, shall we say, a few extra souls that they've known before, or other people that they don't even know, but their existence here is short because they've already went through the things that they needed to. And the veil, as you talked about, with people like me is very thin. And working with the spirits and things on the other side, energies of the other side, gathering energies to protect ourselves, not only bringing this energy within ourselves, but setting it out to protect others. I use tentacles, like an octopus out, and I'll surround people with protective energy of my own to help them when they're having hard times, whether they're sick or emotional problems or whatever it is. So what you're saying is 100% truth. That's the way I believe that we come to this world, into this existence, to experience it, gain all the knowledge and experiences we have. And believe me, I know all of you up out there, some of you just feel like bad luck all the time, but we have to look at our learning experiences. Most of you people that go through that, as I have, become very humble individuals. And you may not have money, but if you see somebody in need, you're willing to take the shirt off your back. We're learning these things, and we need to learn more. And hopefully this will just continue happening, and a whole process of humanity will wake up to this fact. And we won't need this political chaos and everything or sadness going on, because then we'll understand the process. But it does take a student a while to get to a point where they can see. And that's when you take that pill, that matrix fades away or melts away, and then you see reality for what it really is.
Over to you, Bill.
You know, I sit here and I listen to this, and I don't know what I could possibly add. You both said it so well. I've got such a unique perspective on things, you know, since when I died when I was 5, and I've died twice since then. And the thing is, my veil ripped so long ago, I really don't know any other way. I have difficulty understanding people who don't see. I cannot relate to that. I don't understand how someone can walk around deaf, dumb, and blind. To me, that would be just terrible. So there's really nothing I can add to everything you said. One thing I might add, though, is when I was injured and I was paralyzed and I had to relearn how to move, at the time I thought that's just the worst possible thing that could ever happen to me. You know, it was, people think you're paralyzed. Oh, well, you can't feel anything. Well, let me tell you something. It hurt. It hurt terribly, but you can't do anything about it because you can't move. Well, that taught me so much. That experience right there opened my eyes to just what exactly I am and what this body is and just how powerful we are. I taught myself how to move again. Listen, that's no small feat. Now, if I can do this, anyone can do this. And that's what we're about, you know. That's what we're about, teaching people who you really are, raising your consciousness, teaching you how to find yourself, be yourself, and sing your song. Add your song to the harmony of the universe.
Okay, we got a question, a good question, excellent question that we need to address. And the question is this: do you believe there are other realms to be like our own, physical experience? Is this realm supposed to be the glory of being? Your thoughts. So I'll take a whack at this first of all. Yeah, there are many physical realms. This is not the only plane that we manifest on. And many have heard me say this before, that this is the most restrictive form that spiritually you will ever know, because you have to take human form to be grounded to this place of imperfection. We have to be tied to this until such time as we have learned what we came here to learn. And then we can move up having learned that lesson. And sometimes there are several layers to a particular lesson. It's like peeling the skins off an onion. You go, whoa, great. Oh, I've learned that. I finally learned it. Yeah, I got it. I got a hold of that. I can peel that layer of the onion off. You get to the next layer of the onion and darn it if it isn't there again in a different form. Yeah, I think there are many realms. I'm very aware that there are many spiritual realms as well. We live in a 3D world, what we perceive as a 3D world, which is very, very restrictive. We have a very narrow band of vision. We have a very narrow band of experience. And one of the things that's happening in this material world and this world of technology is that our band of worldview is becoming very narrow. We've lost the contact at a fundamental mundane level with this world. And it's one of the things that we need to get back to. The powers that be want to move us away from that grounding to the planet and understanding the vibrations of the planet. They want you totally focused on a different frequency and totally, totally distracted. Is this the glory of being? You're a manifestation of God. How can it be anything but a glorification of your existence? You choose to manifest here. You choose to take on a particular aspect of imperfection and the lessons thereof and carry that message back for all to share when you return. By the way, don't worry about ascension. Your ascension's guaranteed. It has to be. Thou art God, my friend. It cannot be any other way. There is no judgment as far as I am concerned. At the end of it, there is no right. There is no wrong. There is only that that is. But of course, we make choices of how we choose to live our lives. We choose to live our lives righteously. We choose to live our lives well. Or we can choose not to. Again, each is an aspect of the lesson. And remember something. When you reach out to another soul and help that soul in whatever way, you know what? That's going to come back to you. And it's going to come back to you threefold in ways you can't even anticipate. But you know what? If you do something that most would perceive as being wrong, it has a nasty way of coming back to you tenfold. And keep repeating. Over to you, William.
You know, Tony, I was just thinking about what you were saying there about these energy levels. And the way I've taught is what your energy level is in this world, if you're very negative and everything, dark, evil, whatever, when you pass on, that is the energy level where you're going to be in with the other spirits with those particular type of energy levels. Yes. I mean, we are going to go on. I don't believe in hell. I believe that we learn in this world what is going on. We do perceive energy levels. We can feel it with our hands, with our body, with our spirit, on many different levels. The aspects of us, ourselves, on what energy level we are going to be in really depends on us. You know, Bill, you brought up the near-death experiences. I've been there twice myself, electrocuted in front of my wife and child, all my family, 24,000 volts, 350 amps, fried me quick and dead. And I learned so much about the other side from that, and that's how come I really don't worry much. You know, the saying they have out there, no fear. Ladies and gentlemen, if you could get to the point of understanding what that really is, then you wouldn't have these problems in the world. You would understand that we are here to experience these things. We're going to go through our ups and our downs, but without doing these things, we couldn't understand the deeper levels of ourselves, of consciousness, even just our simple daily actions of what we do all the time. And, you know, it's very, and the glory of being, well, we're already there. I have to agree with Tony on that. We are taking ourselves higher and higher, as therefore our glory, if you were talking about energy levels, and that's the way I have to look at it, is getting higher and higher all the time. So, yes, the more we progress, the more we are getting to this higher essence of ourselves, where we need to be. Because, let's face it, you know, this body that we have, as I call our Volkswagen of life, we're just here a short period of time, but we learn so much about emotions, about one another, about really what makes life tick. So when we go to the other side, we just add this to this collective. And that's the best way to put it. You know, we are part of a larger collective that is cosmic. And it's up to us either to step on there or step off. And those of us who never get the chance to learn from somebody and experience will keep coming back. And until we understand these levels and how to bring them up within ourselves, I believe I've seen it in too many people. And yes, there are many different realms, both spiritually and physically, multi-dimensions, multiverse, if you wish to use the term. So don't think there isn't, because there are. I've been to several of them through ceremonies. Yes, I've used different things, peyote, you know, ayahuasca, things of this nature, but I did not use them until I was aware enough in the teachings, and my teachers agreed, okay, now you developed to this point, let's take you to this next point. I do not agree that it is for everybody, but I will say that they are very, very beneficial to those who are ready, and their instructors say, okay, you're grounded enough, you understand yourself enough to take this next level of teaching to a higher realm.
Yeah, I mean, you don't have to do it with chemicals. There are a lot of people who try and avoid the whole learning curve and do it with some kind of drug enhancement. I would say it's better that you're already trained before you do it rather than the other way around. But, Bill, I'm handing the mic across to you.
Yeah, I agree. I had a lot of training before I ever even thought about going into that area. In fact, I don't use any of those substances personally. I don't need to. As far as do I believe there are other realms like our own? No, I don't believe. I know. I've been there. There is a part of me. I've died so many times now that death walks right beside me. There are times when I am in touch with pieces of myself that do exist in other realms and other universes, and I see what my other selves see. I am in very much in touch with these other worlds. The world that I went to when I died, everything was alive, and at some point we'll talk about this in the future, but everything is alive. The color is alive. You can't believe, you think you've seen color in this life. No, you haven't. I'm talking color that is alive. There was a movie that I saw many years ago, had Robin Williams in it. He was this doctor and his wife died. It was called What Dreams May Come. And I'll never forget that movie because that was so much what it was like. When I was living in this other place, it is so hard to describe. Everything is alive. Everything is alive. The sky, the air, the universe, I went to a place, I went to a particular planet that I'm from, and I can talk a little bit about that, but where I went, yes, everything is alive. The buildings, the town that I live in, I don't know. It's all a blur. It seems to just be one long continuous thing. The town that I live in was a very small town. Almost reminded me of what Boulder used to look like years and years ago. It's almost like an artist colony, and the individuals there are constantly changing. How do I describe this? Some of these individuals would change their appearance as you're talking to them. So one moment you're talking to a guy with the head of a dog, and depending on his mood, He's now morphing into half kitty cat and half something else. In other words, you decide how you present yourself to others. It's a completely different type of existence. I don't know how to describe this, except that all I can say is that everything is alive, everything is connected, and that there is no lie. There can be no lie. I don't know how to characterize it, guys. I'm sorry.
Well, we've discussed this before, and, you know, there comes a point where you can't write this stuff down. You can't explain this to someone else, because unless you've been there, unless you've experienced it, it's like trying to describe to a man who's been blind from birth and trying to describe to him the color turquoise. You have no common ground. You have no terms that he can understand. You can maybe describe it as a warmth or something that he could have experienced. But literally, the Pythagorean mystery school never wrote anything down. Everything was first-hand experiential. And one person's experience was never the same as the next person's experience, because everybody learned what they had to learn their own way. And it's one of the reasons why when I teach, I strictly teach one-to-one. I tried on one occasion to try and work with two people at the same time, and their growth rate was so different, and they were off in a different direction. We got a question. We're not going to have time to address it, but we can consider it during the break. And it's, how do you describe a ninth dimension experience in three-dimensional worlds? So maybe we can think about that over the break. I also do not want to move on from a question earlier, which said, how do you find somebody to teach you, really? Not just a shaman, but somebody to teach you. And we live in the most amazing time right now, where we have the internet, and which is a tool that we never had before. You know, we used to have to sit face to face and teach somebody. But I've done some experiments over the internet, where I wanted to see if I could actually do a meditation. And I experimented with a friend of mine who lived a long way away over in Florida. And it works. And so the beauty of that is it's actually made it easier to reach out to other people who can teach you. I want to address that because I want to be able to help the people who are looking to start their journey. But we live in a time of accelerated growth right now. And I, for example, was taught how to teach someone in 6 months what used to take a lifetime to achieve. We are coming hot up on the break, so we're going to consider that question and try and give you as best an answer as we can. And we're going to try and take it back to fundamental level. So we will be back immediately after the break. Seasons don't feel the reaper, nor do the wind, the sun, or the rain. We can be like they are. Come on, baby, don't feel the reaper. Baby, take my hand, don't feel the reaper. On your way through this hard venture, you will be tested. This is the Truth Frequency Radio Network. And we're back, guys, and I apologize for the technical break. Poor Chris was putting gas in his car, and I went, Chris, the show's died, the show's dropped. So as far as I understand, he's currently sitting in McDonald's somewhere using their Wi-Fi, and he managed to kick everything back into life. But I don't want you to miss out on any aspect of this show. And we carried on, hopefully, recording, even though it wasn't being rebroadcast out to you guys. So what I'm going to do is this. ZenShaman.com and also Beyond2012.com. Beyond2012Radio.com, which is my new website. As soon as I get the high-definition copy, I'm going to edit it, and I'm going to post it on my website, and also Zen's going to post it on his. so you can get to hear everything that was said behind the scenes, because I think it's important to a lot of you, and a lot of you I know were getting very frustrated because the show dropped, and I want you to be able to get the benefit of that. It'll probably not go on either website until probably tomorrow, but it will be posted in there. There will be a direct link. You'll be able to download the whole thing or just listen to it, whatever you want to do. And I don't want you to miss out on this, because I feel right now this is really important. It will also be on the Truth Frequency archives, but I'll tell you now, there's a high chance that there's going to be a lot of gaps, and you're going to hear what was said behind the scenes. And, you know, the, oh, my God, we're not on air anymore. But I want you to be able to share it, so we're going to do the extra bits and pieces to make sure that you get it. We're in the final long half hour of this show, and I hope you're all enjoying it. And I really do appreciate all of you sitting and listening to us. But I wanted to give you a special show, which really I feel is appropriate. You know, we've had a tough couple of weeks, guys, all of us, you know, wondering what the heck 21st was going to bring for us all. And I wanted to be able to give you a more relaxed show, but an educational, instructional kind of show. And we really want to go back over a couple of things quickly that we covered before. And that is, you know, how do you find the right person? How do you take the initial steps? How can you be as sure as you can be to get it right? And William is so eloquent tonight that I'm just going to pass it across to him, because I don't think I can put it better than he can. Over to you.
Thank you, Tony. You know, I was just thinking about this when you were talking about how do people start on this path, you know, and really understand what's going on. And I said, you know, we need to look in the mirror. We have to want to, because we feel a need to change. But, you know, I want to go over that just to add a few more things. You know, start by checking out various belief systems, you know, read some spiritual books and talk to people from different cultures and see how you feel. But like I said, you need to turn around and go by energy, you know, how you feel about something. The aspects of becoming a shaman, it takes years to really do this, you know, if you're being trained traditionally like I was. But the internet, like Tony said, is out there. So look around, shop, you know, really look for what's going on out there. But the fact is, everybody thought the end of the world, this Mayan calendar thing and everything. No, they meant this transition. We're going through a transition right now of awakening, coming out of this darkness and this chaos that we've been living in, and people all around are waking up. That's why governments are falling out there right now, because you people out there are waking up. Bill?
Right. That's exactly right. This whole Mayan thing has been misinterpreted, and this is about consciousness. This is about a galactic alignment. This is about alignment of our consciousness. More people are becoming aware of our mother spirit here than I can recall in all the time that I've been watching this place. I don't know about you, William, but I have never seen such an awakening to our mother spirit. Have you?
Negative. This is something big, you know. This is global. And just like, you know, we all know what's happening to our planet stuff. So, you know, there's a lot of factors that are waking people up, Tony.
Yeah, I was just going to say, you know, just be aware that those that in power that shouldn't be are trying every tactic they can to distract you, to fill you with fear, to take you away from absolutely everything that you can be. And yeah, it takes time to reach a level where really, I mean, and we don't call ourselves shaman. Other people call us shaman. And you know, it's something you have to strive for. But hey, that doesn't mean that we didn't all have to take the first step at some stage. And the amazing thing is, whenever you take that first step, you as an individual, and I'm talking to you now, you are the one that takes that first step. And that first step may not seem very dramatic to you. It's a tiny, tiny, tiny baby step that carries you on a whole new journey. And remember, every journey starts with that first step and that willingness to take the first step and that desire to take that first step. So you know, don't just jump on the first bandwagon that comes along. Be discerning. Look at it. See what fits. You'll know. You will know what fits. You will know that you don't have to force yourself into making something fit. I mean, for me, I was intrigued by the Indian faiths and Indian gurus. Yes, I was intrigued, but it didn't fit. It didn't fit me. But I took a good look at it, and I met a few people. I looked at the Melchizedek network that there is. It didn't fit. It did not fit for me. And it wasn't till ultimately, I mean, I looked at White Eagle Lodge, which is a worldwide healing organization. And I met the top people and sat and spoke with them for about 2 hours. It didn't fit for me. They agreed that it wasn't a good fit for me. And it took me some while before I found what was on my own doorstep. And what I'm saying to you is, you will know when it's right. You will know when it fits like a glove. And so use that aspect of your own intuition to find what you're looking for. And you know, we are here for you, all three of us. You can contact all three of us. And in a few minutes, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a way that you can contact us. And so get a pen and paper. And in a few minutes, I'm going to give you the means by which you can get in touch with any one of us. And, you know, take it from there. If we can help you, we can help you. If it isn't a fit, you're not going to offend any of us. Over to you, William.
You know, I couldn't put it any better way. I'm in Bill's position now, you know. How can you say anything better than that right there? Really, your teacher and you will mesh right. It's a charismatic thing. I teach one way. Bill teaches one way. Tony teaches another way. So that shows you. But you know, what's funny is we're all coming to the same conclusion, the same apex of understanding of who and what we are in connection and conjunction with everything else around us. It's what I call a reality check, you know. But I wake up every morning with the attitude of gratitude, thankful for what I have, what I've learned, because I know everything that I learn in this existence goes with me, because I've been there before. So when you leave this world, everything you learn in this existence does go with you. So that backs up what Tony said about we're vessels of, you know, we just gathering, sucking up this information on the physical plane and then going to the other side, adding it to the collective. That is how it really is. And I just have to say it's a great journey. That's it. That's all I can say.
I agree. I'm going to go ahead and jump in and just kind of agree with that. We've all come to this position in very different ways, but we are in a complete agreement. As far as I'm concerned, I'm in complete agreement with everything you've said, Brother William, and everything that you've said, Tony. I'm even going to go so far as to say that if you come to either one of us, you're probably going to hear the same answer. I believe that we're all saying the same thing, and this path is a very individual journey, but as you can see, we have a consensus and we've all ended up at the same spot.
It really goes back to what I was saying about the closer that you are to the hub, the more you realize the similarities of all the different pathways. And this is why I always, my argument with religion has always been, why do you always focus on your differences? Why can you not celebrate your commonalities? And it's not important which pathway you take. What's important is that you've undertaken the journey. And you know what? The closer we all get to the center, the closer we all get to the source. And indeed, when we all return to the source, we're all the same. We all want the same things. We all want peace in our lives. We all want to be loved. We all want not to feel alone. We all want to feel that our life has a purpose. And your life does have a purpose. You know, people say, well, you know, what is the meaning of life? Is it just to come here, to eat, to experience the world, be happy, suffer some misery, procreate? Is that really all that it is? And that was my question. That was my question at the beginning of the journey. Is this really all there is to it? And you know what, folks? There's a lot more to it. There's a lot more than just the 3D world. And each of you can attain that level. And all you have to do is undertake that journey. But do yourself a favor. When you take your first steps, metaphorically stick a flag in the ground so you can remember what it was like when you knew nothing. Because I guarantee as you move from that first tiny baby step, you will forget what it was like when you knew nothing. And the fact that you drove that flag in the ground means at least you can relate to somebody who is just starting out. And that's important. I teach all of my students that. People say, well, you know, what books should I read? I'm not a great advocate of books because all that I teach is one-to-one, first-hand, experiential. But I will share this with you. There are two books that I recommend to my students, and only two. The first book is Jonathan Livingston Seagull by Richard Bach. It's a very small book. It's very inexpensive, and I gift each of my students a copy of this. And I say, before you even start, sit down and read it. And they do. And I say, once they've read it, I say, right, now put it away. We're going to work together for 6 months. At the end of 6 months, I want you to read it again. And it's like they're reading it for the first time. The other book that I recommend to my students is The Celestine Prophecy. Now, it's a very good gauge of where you are at right now spiritually, where you are developmentally. And those are the only two books, in my opinion, that on a spiritual journey you really need to read. Most other books, yes, they're interesting information, but they will teach you how to emulate the author, and that is all. You cannot learn this secondhand through books and through video. Pass the mic over to you, William.
Wow. That's amazing because those are the same two books that I do. And I just finished reading Jonathan Livingston Seagull myself, about 2 weeks ago. Yeah, right there. And it's sitting on my desk right here. The reason that I like to give them two books is they the basic concepts of understanding the transition, the change that the seagull makes. You know, he sees the crowd and he don't want to just fight for the food and all this type of stuff. What he wants to do is fly. And that's what each and every one of us want to do. We want to fly. We want to step out of this mess, this chaos we call this world. But a lot of us just don't know how to do it. Those two books right there are some of the two of the greatest books, I believe, probably ever written. Very, very basic, very simple, and anybody can understand the concepts that they're talking about. But what happens when you read those two books is you grow to a point of understanding, and you look at the world around you, and what did you just do? You took the pill that they have in Matrix, and now your reality is going to take a twist and a change. But it's a wonderful change because they're teaching you about the energy of life, the vibrations of life, the concepts of what we can do, especially in the Celestine Prophecy. The first book, it wakes you up. Celestine Prophecy takes you further in the energies of life. Mountaintops have higher energies than they do in the valleys. Certain sacred spots around the world have different energies. So it's something to really pay close attention to. And it's really interesting, Tony, because I do the same thing right there. I give those same books to my students as well. But I've also had many people ask me, well, I want to understand this belief system. What should I do? You know, what belief system should I study? What book should I read? You know what I tell them? Read them all. Read every single one. Read the Quran. Read the Bible. Read the Bhagavad Gita. Read them all. Understand what they say. Understand the code of Budo. Understand as much as you can. I practiced martial arts for a long time. So I really understand a little more about the Eastern philosophy, you know, than not studying. Not as much as Bill probably does, but I understand some of the basic concepts. And that even attracted me. So when you get pulled into the study of shamanism, you really look at everything and you find out that everything comes to a basic root system. Of that which is. Bill?
Exactly right. And I, once again, I'm going to have to be put in a position of agreeing. Those two books were very instrumental in my life. There are also, well, there's several really. There's two other books that I have used throughout my life that I was introduced to when I was younger. And that is one of them by a man named Joel Goldsmith called As a Man Thinketh. And that really impacted my life very heavily. And then there is another one that I don't know how popular it is anymore. There was a series called A Course in Miracles many years ago. And in fact, listening to Michael Tesserian, it turns out that his grandmother was the one that put that together, which I find very interesting. As a young man, my grandmother was also on this path, and she introduced me to The Course in Miracles. And that impacted my life a lot, as well as, like I said, the Joel Goldsmith book, As a Man Thinketh. So those are two additional ones that I would comment on. But those, Jonathan Livingston Seagull and Celestine Prophecies, that works for me.
I'm going to ask for a little poll in the chat room right now. If you like the show that we've done tonight, what we're considering doing is once a month, and possibly, you know, we'll bring some other shaman in as well. But once a month, we're thinking about running a show like this where you can ask questions, you can ask pertinent questions. We'll do our very best to answer them. But I'm going to ask you in the chat room, those that are named and the Anons as well, if you would like us to do this on a monthly basis, let us know. Let us know you're interested in it. If you're not interested in it, hey, your opinion counts too. But give us some feedback. If you want us to do it, we will do a show once a month where, you know, it's going to be more shamanically orientated. It's going to be spiritually orientated. And you get to ask the questions from at least three people who hopefully are going to be able to come up with the answers. Guys and gals, we do not know it all. I hope you've all got pens and paper, because each of us now is going to give you the means by which you can connect with us. And please check my website tomorrow, which is beyond2012radio.com. And as soon as I've got it edited and all the bad bits edited out, I'm going to post it on my website so that you can listen to the whole show and pick up on the bits that you missed out on. Also, if you go to my website, I have contact page. You can put your message in the contact page. It will come through to my email, and so we can connect up that way. And I'll endeavor to do what I can. Over to you, William. I don't know whether you're going to post the show, but how can folks contact you?
Well, it's pretty easy to contact me. If you just go to williamwhitecrow.com, website that is ever changing. I'm never satisfied with it. So that's where that's at. You can contact me through there. And you can just contact me directly at williamwhitecrow@yahoo.com. And I do answer all emails and all contacts, no matter what. And we're putting out a newsletter also called The Talking Crow. So you can sign up for it at the website there. And we also have a store website called White Crow Enterprises, and White Crow Enterprise Store, .com. It's new. My wife set that up. But go to White Crow Enterprises or White Crow Enterprise Store.com and you can contact me. But like I said, if you really want to talk to me personally, you can go directly with WilliamWhiteCrow@yahoo.com. And that's the best thing that I can say. And on to you, Bill.
My website is zenshaman.com, and you can go to my contact page there and contact me directly there, or you can send me an email, and that is zen@zenshaman.com. And I'm here for you. If you need to talk to somebody, if you need some guidance, get a hold of me through my website, and we can talk. Yeah, so that's how.
We're about 5 minutes out from the end of the show. And, I want you guys to understand, especially those that are considering starting your own personal journey, there are no stupid questions. You are going to have buckets full of questions. And not those answers will come to you as you grow down that pathway. But yeah, you're going to have uncertainties. You're going to have questions. Don't be afraid to ask the questions in your own words. And sometimes the questions are hard to formulate. And I have a philosophy. Think it, say it. Don't try and hone it down so it's a work of precision. Ask the question. We'll do our best between us to answer the questions for you. I haven't had any feedback yet from the chat room, but if you want us to do a monthly shamanic spiritual show, we will do it. I've got a thumbs up from Leanne, so I'm taking it that you'd like us to do that. So, yeah, we'd love. Hang on.
Just remind them that it'll be in our regular.
Right. This will be the regular Beyond 2012 show, which runs from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. Pacific on a Saturday. That's the 2 hours before Chris and Cherie show. So we're coming down now because I waffled down to about 4 minutes. So, guys, what would you like to say in conclusion?
I think the only thing that I'd really like to say, and I know we'll all agree with this, is people, you know, we're all waking up, we're all searching, we're all looking for that which is real in our lives. And there's nothing wrong with, as Tony said, ask any question. When I'm working with my students, I always tell them, ask me the stupidest question first. And we have a good laugh, and we break the ice, and then there's no tension, and we get on with our education. And I said our education. Because as a shaman, we learn as much from you as you learn from us. How about you, Bill?
I think I learned more by listening. I'm not much of a talker. I'm very zen. I prefer to listen. My philosophy is I have two ears and one mouth for a reason. So I try to spend at least as much time listening as I do talking. And the only thing that I can say is love and compassion, brothers and sisters. That is the answer through this. Stop before you go and make a judgment on somebody. We have all lived in ignorance at some point in our existence, and love and compassion is the answer. Seek understanding, and that's really all I can say.
I was just going to say, you know, we've all made our mistakes in life. We are not perfect. We're as human as you are. We are, as I've said many times, we are just travelers on a path. It may be that we're further down the path than some. We're maybe not as far down the path as others. We have our own fallibilities. We are in human form just the same as everyone else. So I hope that you enjoyed this evening. Thank you to everybody who joined us and tolerated the technical outages and all the rest of it. But you will be able to hear what we were saying behind the scenes tomorrow. Please go and take a listen. Really, this was a trial run to see whether this was the kind of show that you people wanted to sit back and listen to, wanted to hear. You're special to us. Each of those that comes to our chat room is special, because without you, we would be talking to dead air. We've had a bit of that tonight as it is, but we would be talking to dead air. You that I'm talking to now, you helped to make this show what it is. Please remember that this is not our regular time that we're covering for Chris and Cherie, and that our regular time will be 4 to 6 Pacific on a Saturday. And we will, by common consensus, we will run this show for you once a month, and hopefully we'll be able to get it set up so that you guys can call in. We weren't able to do that tonight, but so you'll be able to call in and talk directly. Remember, you're special to us, you are important, and though the times may be difficult for a lot of people, oh, and by the way, you can watch Jonathan Livingston Seagull on YouTube. I know for a lot of people right now, money's a little tight, but I got to wind the show up right now, so I'm going to say thank you to William, thank you to Bill, thank you to Chris and Cherie, God bless you both, and we will be back at our regular spot next Saturday. Our love goes out to you all. Stay strong. Stay shiny. In Lakesh.
renegades, castaways, outlaws to the game like Thomas Paine was. They masquerade us, who's to blame? Us now set to explode like a hand grenade does. No peace to cease the police to show peace, at least beef, no belief, peace underneath the beat.